Well, good morning. Thank you all for coming this morning. Smaller group than last, but you'll all be a little more comfortable and be able to engage, I think, a little more later when we get there. Last group was so large they couldn't really have a discussion amongst themselves, but we're going to do that in a little bit. But I want to pick up basically where we left off yesterday. Yesterday I tried to focus on specifically the campus, everybody, from the garden people to the cafeteria to everybody. I think we're all in this together. Today, obviously, it's more about faculty in the classroom, what you all do. What I do in some cases, I'll give you some examples perhaps, but to kind of start thinking through it more specifically today on how to integrate your faith with learning, how to take it to our particular illustration for all of us in the room this morning. To do so, you would think I wouldn't have to do it in a college classroom experience or environment like this. Christian college, don't need to talk about it. Not the case, is it? It's a discussion we have to have almost every year, some to remind, some to encourage. Sometimes because some folks almost want to resist the idea because they don't understand what it's about. And of course, there have been a bunch of books written on it. People have pondered it. A lot of those books talk about the value of it, but what I've discovered is very few of them will talk about how to do it. What does it really look like? One that you might want to look at if you're interested is a book by Robert Harris. The name of it is Integrating Faith and Learning, and the subtitle is a little more specific, but it's like from 2011 or 13. He deals with a little more practical in the classroom, gives some examples of exercises you might do with your students, some biblical verses that might relate to your major so that you have some tie in there. I want to stay as far away from that as we can and kind of still talk global ideas if we can. But the reason why we have to have this discussion and why it's so awkward for some of us is we tend to do what Whit Litvin says in his book, ghettoize our faith. Not in the sense that our students would understand ghetto in terms of a racial epithet, but ghetto in a historical sense that we sequester, right? They ghettoized the Jews in Warsaw. Any major city in America during the influx of immigrants in the early 1900s, there was a Polish neighborhood, a Cuban neighborhood. Even in my little town today, 21st century Goose Creek, 30,000 people in Charleston, there's a Brazilian neighborhood. The Mexicans all tend to live together. And so we do it with our faith also. And what that means, what he means, what I mean by bringing it up, is too many of us tend to leave our faith sequestered on Sunday morning. We open it like our Bible at 11 o'clock, and we close it like our Bible at noon, and we walk away for a week. And we think that somehow it has nothing to do with anything else in our lives. That's what the world wants us to do. I mean, if you remember back during the Bush presidency, regardless of what you may think about the depth of his faith, he was certainly public about it. And they ridiculed him for it. And they basically said as much as, that doesn't belong in the White House. Basically, they wanted him to leave his faith in the car when he came inside. And a lot of Christians do that, whether they're accountants, whether they're professors. A lot of us do it sometimes. We just forget. We get into the moment of the classroom and we forget what we're doing. We cover the material we got to cover, but then all of a sudden you realize, man, I didn't really talk about Jesus today. And that's true of all of us. That's not just, you know, picking on one discipline or another. Every discipline can struggle with that because this is the way we've been raised. Because think about it, good Southern folk, most of us are old enough to remember, back in the day, there were three things you didn't talk about in public. Politics, sex, which that's obviously now changed because that's public fodder, and you didn't talk about religion. 50 years ago, you didn't need to because everybody went to church. And they got used to the idea that we don't talk about in public, and now it's don't talk about in public because you might offend me and you crossed the barrier of tolerance. And so we still do it, and we've got to be intentional about not getting caught in our little theological Christian ghetto away from it all. There's reasons for that, why we're so prone to fall into that trap. Some of us, because some of us are introverts. Some of you are introverts. You know it. You admit it. Some of you are extroverts. I recently found out there are actually all kinds of introverts and extroverts. I had a couple in my church. I thought he was the introvert and she was the extrovert. And based on some research they'd read, it was actually reversed. But some of us are just a little awkward. You know, you get on stage in the classroom and you turn it on, but what happens the moment you walk away from the lectern? It's a light switch. You turn it off and you move on. Some of it is, though, that we're spiritually introverts. We don't want to talk about those things. We're uncomfortable bringing it up. How do you transition even in a one-on-one conversation with your students about faith? Well, this is an awkward moment, you know. Or we encountered people back in the day who weren't introverts spiritually, but they would bring up, you know, well, if you were to die today and go, you know, to stand before God, where would you go? And we found that as awkward. And so we want to make sure we're not that way. And so it's a struggle. This is a real struggle. This is not to beat anybody up for not integrating or having difficulties. It's a struggle. And so we write books about it, dozens of books about it. If you go back over the last 20 years or so, lots of books have come out on it. And what you'll discover is when you read them, almost none of them offer the how-tos. This is an easier discussion to have, big picture rather than specific. I'm going to follow that pattern for the most part this morning because I want you all to talk about some of the how-tos, because some of you are already doing it very well, and I want you to share your ideas with each other. But again, I also want to think bigger picture. I want to give you principles to think through, some challenges to go, oh, how does that look in my class? Or what does that feel like in my life? And so that's kind of how we're going to proceed, is how to get us out of the ghetto and into the classroom. But interestingly, I just used that word, and now I'm going to tell you the opposite. How's the wrong question to ask first? How's where we want to begin? Your students want to do that, right? They want to get to the practical. How's this going to work? How's this relevant to my life? How am I going to get a job with this information? For us, anyway, it's the wrong place to begin. I mentioned this book yesterday from Simon Sinek, Start With Why. He won a TEDS award. If some of you are not familiar with that, it's a public speaking award. You get videotaped, you submit it. They pick the best public speaker of the year, and they give him a financial prize for it. He also got a book deal out of it called Start With Why. I'd encourage you to go watch it on YouTube, put those qualifiers in. It's about 8 or 10 minutes. It's a great presentation, not on faith. It's actually a presentation on marketing in the business world. But the principles, if they're true, apply where? Everywhere. And his argument is, thinking again from the business standpoint, why is a more important question than the how. He says, think about it. Back in the day, IBM was going to change the world with personal computers. They were the biggest, right? You bought a computer, didn't matter what brand you bought. How did you qualify it? What do you got? I've got an IBM. What operating system? IBM. That was become like Kleenex or Xerox. It became the universal term for a personal computer. You realize they don't make personal computers anymore. They didn't make money at it eventually and moved on. Apple comes out, they start, and looking around the room, a lot of you got Apple products in front of you. I've noticed if you look at my laptop, what's on the back side? The Apple. It's not facing me. I want you to know I've got an Apple. Right? Because it's a statement about you, not about the computer. It's a thing we want others to pick up on. And think about it, are Apples really any better than most computers? No, and I can tell you back in the day when I was in advertising, they were probably worse. They were unstable, they crashed all the time. You know, I learned to back up and save every keystroke. But when I went to college in my mid-30s, I needed a computer for home. I went to go buy an Apple because that's what I did at school, Macintosh, or at work. I realized I couldn't afford one. And that's still generally true today. You can go buy a laptop that is a PC for $200 or $300. You go buy a basic Apple laptop, you're going to spend $1,000 or more. Why do we do it? That's what he's asking. And the difference is, he says, is Apple began with the question of why. Not what do we make, because lots of people make computers. How do we do it? They all make computers essentially the same way. Why Apple? And he points, I think rightly, back to 1984 at the Super Bowl. Some of you are old enough to remember. At the Super Bowl, big thing about the commercials, that's about really when it started, is there's this great commercial, this Orwellian scene of people just kind of rocking back and forth, kind of hypnotized, and somebody comes running in from the back of the scene and throws a giant hammer into the screen and explodes Big Brother. And all of a sudden, buying an Apple or a Macintosh meant you were counterculture. You were better than, you were different than. And so it became an identifying mark for you. And so what I want us to see is, when we're talking about integrating faith and learning, the how is up to you. To some degree, the what depends on your discipline. The why is what we're talking about. Why do we integrate faith and learning in the classroom? Because that's going to drive what we do and how we do it. And so for those of you who are Macintosh users or Apples, early adopters, because it's the new one, same kind of thought here. We need to ask why we want to do these things, more so first than before we get to the question of the what's and the how's. And so we start thinking about this, and following his principles, I'm going to argue what we're going to do in the next 40 minutes or so is not about what we do. It's not about how we do it, though we're going to tap into that a little bit, because that's what you're here for, is kind of get some ideas, some thought starters. I want to start again with the why. Not as a campus now, but in the classroom, why as teachers do we do what we do? Why you should integrate faith and learning into what you're doing in the classroom? Yesterday I gave you some biblical principles, talked about the great commandments, love the Lord your God, love your neighbor, and then we talked about the Great Commission. I want to bring some biblical into it here again to integrate faith even in this discussion. And I want to start with Genesis chapter 1. It's a great place to start, right? In the beginning. The verse we're picking up in is in the middle of the sixth day, after Adam and Eve are created, God gives them the first commandment in the entire Bible. This is the first commandment. This is what is known sometimes as the creation ordinance or the cultural mandate. And so here's what he tells them to do, and you're familiar with it. It says, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. What is he telling them to do? At the initial level, he's telling them to procreate. There's more animals than you. Go procreate. Go make children. This is how your children are going to have spouses and so forth. Apply it to a bigger context. How does it relate to us? Because we're not in the garden. This is essentially the same command we're given as Christians in the Great Commission. What are we told to do? Go and make disciples. What are we told? Go multiply. And so the principle holds from the beginning of the Bible to the beginning of the church. We're there to multiply. The second part of the command also applies to both contexts, and that is we are to subdue it. Adam, the subduing was maybe to domesticate, maybe to harvest. It certainly was part of the naming of the animals, an ultimate sign of sovereignty. Adam was sovereign over the animals. He gave them their names. God was sovereign over them. He gave them their names. Jesus was proving his sovereignty in the New Testament by changing people's names. But how does this relate to us? Because we're also to subdue the earth. We're God's ambassadors, we're God's representatives. But part of the task of the Great Commission is, right, go be fruitful, make disciples, and teach them to do what? To obey all that I've commanded you. Subdue it. And so part of the task of the church and part of our institutional task as Christian College is to subdue the earth for the kingdom, to go capture every corner, to bring it all under the umbrella, not by our force or our wit, but under God's leadership, bringing it into, if you will, the fold. Paul picks up on that in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Now, if you know anything about 2 Corinthians, you know you don't want to belong to the Church of Corinth, unless you live in Corinth, Mississippi. Otherwise, you're not going to find anybody naming their church 1 Corinthians Baptist Church, because you don't want to be that church. It is arguably the most messed up church in the New Testament. And he writes, some scholars suggest, four letters back and forth to them, trying to help them think through their issues. So this is at least the second letter, maybe part of the fourth, depending on your interpretation of that matter. But notice what he tells them, though he's scolding them for their worldliness. They have fallen into the trap of letting the church become like the world, rather than vice versa. They're no longer subduing. He says, let me remind you. We, talking about Christians, not just Paul, not just the Corinthians, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. That's part of our task. That's part of the subduing. Now, certainly there are a lot of arguments out there against the church, a lot of lofty opinions. The illustration I've used earlier today is Richard Dawkins. Some of you are familiar with him. He's outspoken, he's mean-spirited, he's hateful towards Christianity and any religion, and his followers drink the Kool-Aid and repeat everything he says, and they assume they're being intellectual doing it because that PhD said it. Paul says, no, we can destroy their arguments, and we can bring down those lofty opinions raised against the knowledge of God. The second part of the verse is how we do it. We take every thought captive. That's integrating faith and learning. That's why it's important you do it in every discipline. That's why it's not just in the religion departments. That's why it's not just relegated to chapel on Thursdays. That's why it's not just a job of the resident life people to do it in their small groups with their students. It's your job. In fact, other than their roommates and friends, you're going to spend more time with them than anybody else on campus for the next 4 years. You're going to have as much influence as anybody. And so you're molding and shaping. You're helping them think through how to do the very thing we're commanded as Christians to do, how to take those thoughts captive. And so in one sense, not only is integrating faith and learning expected, it's mandated. We have to do it. As believers, the failure to do it is a huge sin issue on our part. Some of us have got to get over our introvert nature and figure out how to do it, even when we're uncomfortable. Because now, as a command of God, it's not an option, it's the expectation of us. And so Paul says we're to take every thought captive, to bring these things around and bring it under, if you will, the dominion of God and His world. That's the quest we're talking about. Now, the way we begin to think about it, to start transitioning some of your thought patterns about this, is I want to take you to something Dr. Brewer brought up yesterday, and that is Martin Luther, the great reformer. His doctrine of vocation, vocatio, comes in a book called Freedom of the Christian, written in 1521. He wrote three books in 1 year. He writes this in argument against the Catholic Church. He's talking about the priesthood of all believers. You don't need to go to the priest in the Catholic Church or the Pope for your mediation with Christ. You can go directly. And in essence, you are responsible for the spiritual well-being of those around you. Thus, some of you have heard in your church in the last couple decades, every member is a minister. That's this doctrine applied to us. But specifically for us as professors, I want to apply it a little further, taking his ideas as he explains them in other writings. We need to be reminded that we are not professors who happen to be Christians. We're Christians who happen to be professors. And so this is just one thing we do as Christians. I'm also a Christian who happens to be a father, or a Christian who happens to be a husband, or a coach, or whatever it is. And so all of a sudden, when you start realizing that paradigm shift, because in our American culture, what's the first thing we ask somebody when you first meet them? What do you do? We do it at faculty meetings, right? We introduce them as, this is their messenger, this is their discipline. You know, as we're intermingling with the crowd. You know, I'm trying to work the room, get to know some of you all. What do you do? Now, of course, if we're going to be honest, we often then start measuring, well, where'd you go to school? Where do you live? Where are you from? Because we want to start evaluate them. Luther says that's the wrong question. Who are you as Christian? And that way, if one day you can no longer teach, you're still a Christian. You know, when people start getting laid off en masse in the 80s and 90s during that recession, there were a lot of suicides, just like in the Great Recession of the 2000s. Because people, when they lost their jobs and they lost their homes and they lost their cars, lost their sense of identity, because that's who they were. Luther says, what a waste. They're Christians who happen to drive that car or live in that neighborhood. And so when it comes to this idea of integrating our faith and learning, let me encourage you, first of all, switch the paradigm. You're a Christian who just happens to do this for a season of your life. Our students, you know, the surveys are telling us, recruiters are telling us that the average student, not only will they change their major multiple times in college and really delay the process, they're now saying that most of the students who are leaving our schools in this generation, they are going to change careers 4 or 5 times during their working life. In many ways, their major doesn't matter, because that's just a launching point for something else. The industry is going to change. There are going to be new jobs you never heard of in 20 years. But if we can teach them to be Christians, they can do that wherever they're at, because their identity is in Christ, not in their vocation. And so Luther begins to give us some grasp here of what we're doing. The great theologian Augustine also did so. Augustine wrote this. He says, understanding is the reward of faith. This is the idea that Aquinas would have explained it. This is faith, beginning with faith, seeking understanding or knowledge. But I love the way Augustine says it better, because what he tells us is we as people of faith get opportunity, privilege, to dig into ideas, and when we learn, it's a reward. It's the outcome of our faith, not the object of our faith. And so again, that changes how you intersect your thoughts, your teaching, your discipline with your students and faith. Because all of a sudden, not only is it a privilege to be in the classroom, which we often tell them, this is God telling us something about Himself. That's revelation. And not everybody has that revelation. And so when they get the privilege of being in your classrooms, they're getting to learn something about God, perhaps, that no one else they know knows. That's a great reward. And so we're building off that kind of thinking here, that it's a blessing to do this. In Litvin's book, Conceiving the Christian College, he says, well, our goal is to teach our students not only to measure the information, but to celebrate it. Right? This outcomes-based learning is more than just, you must learn this information. One of our SLOs has to be, they come to know something more about God in the process. And that's where oftentimes those SLO models fail, because they don't take that next step. we as Christian educators need to go the next step. We want them to learn it, to measure it, but then we want to celebrate that information because they've learned something new about God. We want them to worship. Mark Knoll, a Christian historian that I'll reference again a little bit, said this. He said, the point of education in the Christian environment is to praise God with our mind. See, it's not about educating them. It's not about simply giving them vocational tools so they can get a job when they graduate. Because as you all know, they can get that at lots of other places. The value that we add is that we bring God into the equation and make Him the center of it. And so when they see these things, they can now praise God. Something new and amazing. I remember years ago, the first time I went to Salt Lake City to go skiing, flew in at night, flying in over the Wasatch Mountains. I was able to look out the window, look down, saw the snow in the mountains. I'm amazed by the snow, even from 30,000 feet. But then I happened to notice, man, it's black in the sky. And so I looked up, and because it was pitch black out in the middle of nowhere, I could see for the first time in my life, probably since I'd been in the Army, how many millions of stars. And all of a sudden it became a worship moment, not a moment of excitement. I'm going to get to ski tomorrow on that mountain. I'm under this heaven that God created. That's flipping the way we see things. Arthur Holmes, who probably is really the founder, the father of this idea of integrating faith and learning, in one of his books said what we're trying to do is get to the point of doxological learning. Now, if you've been in church very long, especially if you went to a traditional church, you know what the doxology is, right? It was old blessed number hymn 6. And we sang it every Sunday as they were bringing the offering plates and putting them on the table up front, right? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all ye creatures here below. That's not what he's talking about. Here's your little Greek lesson for the day. Doxological is two Greek words slammed together. The second word, which we get logical, is the word logos. It is the word for word, i.e. in John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That's the word logos. It's the idea in Greek philosophy of the single force that holds the universe together. It's the source. So when Jesus says, I'm the Word, what's he saying? I'm the center of the universe. And you all use it. Many of you have disciplines where you have a logi at the end of your discipline title. We teach biology. So you teach a word about bios, life. Geology, life, a word about rocks, the world, terra firma. And so this is a word about something. The funny word is the word dokos, the beginning. It is the Greek word for weight, W-E-I-G-H-T. And you go, okay, I'm real confused now. And this is why it's important, because the Bible's full of doxologies. In fact, when you read the book of Psalms, there are five books in the book of Psalms. Each one of them ends with a doxology. And the fifth book ends with five doxologies, Psalm 146 through the end. The word dokos means weight, and what the concept is that when you put God in the scales of value, because that's how they measured value in the New Testament, when you put God in the scales, you find Him to be weighty. To use the 60s language, He's heavy. To use banking language, He's valuable. And so as we study these things in our different disciplines, we realize God is eminently valuable, and thus we worship. Thus we have a doxology moment as we think about and we learn something new. And so our goal is to get our students to see the value of God in every class we teach, to see how they relate to the Creator of the universe and His Son. We want them to come away as worshipers, not just merely learners. Because there are a lot of learners in the world. The worshipers is what we've been tasked to go create, because that's what ultimately evangelism is, isn't it? Is to go make worshipers of God, who worship them with his mind, the body, and soul, and those other things in the Great Commandment. But where do we begin to do it? That's kind of the point of this session, isn't it? Where do we begin to do it? Well, you got to begin with yourself. You got to back up from the classroom a little bit before you even enter the door, begin with yourself. And the first thing you got to realize is you need to be Christians. Now, obviously, I mean big sense, you got to be saved. Because that's the connection, isn't it? The Bible says these things are foolishness to those who don't believe. That's why it's hard for a non-believer to integrate faith and learning. Because you can't share what you don't have. And so the assumption is you're a Christian. But you got to be Christian in a thoroughgoing sense. But here's where I really want to challenge you on, step on some toes. You have to be disciples yourself. Now, disciple obviously means Christian, but I mean in the sense that you are a disciplined learner yourself. Just as you study your discipline to try to keep up on the latest and greatest information, and you read the newest books, and you try to follow the newest arguments, where we fail sometimes as the church is we very often fail to do that as Christians. I don't mean going to Sunday school, though that's a way to be discipled. I don't mean going on Sunday night to the old discipleship training union, though that's part of it, or your small group study. I mean you all are responsible in large measure for your own theological maturity. And if you're going to integrate faith and learning in everything you do, you've got to have that information to deal with. And so, you know, one day your student's going to throw back in your face, well, what about? Well, you can be honest, say, I don't know, let me go look, I'll get back to you. But if you say, I don't know enough, what do? They quit asking. You've lost your credibility. So you've got to be a disciple. You've got to figure out not only your faith and do your own doctrinal studies and think through some of these things on your own. You've got to start thinking through, how does this apply to my discipline? And I'm pretty sure that you're probably going to be able to find some Christian books out there on your topic. They may not be great. They may not be always on point. But you've got to discipline yourself to do it. And you've got to be able to become, in one sense, a theologian in your own classroom. Because really, theology is not this big picture, big thick doorstop kind of book. You know what the word theology really means? Remember logi, word. It's a word about theos, theo, God. And if he's the most important thing and we're to love him with our entire being, guess what will be the number one topic that we study? And so we're all to be theologians. We can't take this anti-intellectual approach that so many seemingly do in a modern church, where the whole theology is for those guys. No. Theology is for who? It's for all of us. Because you can't, and this is not what the book was meant to do when she wrote it, but Anne Graham Lott wrote a book in the late 90s called Don't Give Me Theology, Just Give Me Jesus. And what she was dealing with is, let's quit getting into all these petty theological squabbles and distracting ourselves from the main task. Let's quit eating our young. But what the world hears and what many in our churches hear is, we don't have to do theology, I just have to be a believer in Christ. Well, as soon as you say, don't give me theology, just give me Jesus, you've committed a theological fallacy. Because you can't talk about Jesus without doing theology. And so to be a Christian, guess what it automatically presupposes? You're a theologian. And so you've got to discipline yourself to do this, to become more thoroughgoing as time goes on. And let me give you an encouraging word about theology. This comes from a guy named William Ames. Ames wrote in 1603, published his theology book. He was an English Puritan who was persecuted, left England, and went to the continent. But his book became the textbook for theology for the Puritans, the Congregationalists, many of the dissenters, not only in England, but in America, into the middle 1700s. In fact, if you wanted to graduate from Yale with a master's degree, Jonathan Edwards, for example, did this. To graduate with his master's degree, you didn't merely write a thesis, you did that. You had to defend all of it, just like you did with your doctoral dissertation, but you had to do it in Latin, and you had to do it on command from Ames. This is your conclusion. Where does Ames say that? But the very first sentence in the book, I think, is instructive, not only for what the book is really about, Marrow of Theology is the name of the book, but what it is we're talking about. Theology is, and we could add nothing more than, the doctrine of living to God. It's not information for information's sake, it's information for living's sake. It changes the way you are. If you're not changed by what you discover about God, you've not really discovered anything about God yet. That's what we want our students to do, therefore we've got to do it first. And so we've got to interact with God and Christ at this theological level, not deep, rich. You don't have to be able to argue at a great level with a true theologian, but you've got to be a theologian in your own sort, because it impacts how you live your Christian life. And that's what Ames is looking at. That's what we're talking about. So let's bring this into the classroom for a few moments here. Here's where you're going to go, okay, here's the how-to. I've been waiting. He started these thoughts yesterday. Now he's got it. I can't teach you to do you. I can't teach you how to do me. When I won that teaching award that was mentioned yesterday, several years ago, they asked me the next year to come in and do a faculty thing for our faculty and talk about what it is you do in the classroom that the students respond so well to. Now, this is not false humility. This was I don't know what I do. I've never thought about it. My training, I had no pedagogical training all the way through my doctorate. I was being prepared for the classroom without being prepared for the classroom. And so I couldn't tell you what I did. And it dawned on me, you know, the only thing I can think it must be is me being me. Me being my personality, me being my history, my past, all coming together with my theology, and it comes out. I can't teach you to be me. And I can't teach you to do you. Several years ago, a movie some of you might recognize, Drumline, with Nick Cannon, young inner city boy recruited out of New York City to go to a black college in the South to play drums. Incredibly talented. He comes in, he gets a full ride. He's the bonus baby, as his friends call him. And one day it's found out he can't read music. And the band director is livid because that was part of the qualifications. You have to be able to read music. And so he suspends him from the band, signs him up for a basic instrumental course, how to read music. Funny thing is he's offended. You can't make me do that. That'll give me 15 hours. And, you know, I'm going as a teacher. 15 hours? The problem here is what? But he makes an interesting observation. He says, I'm going to put you in this class so you can learn how to do this. And the young boy responds. He says, there ain't no class that could teach me to do me. Now, he did learn how to read music, and it helped make him better. But guess what he already was? Him. And that's kind of what we're doing here. Is I always want to give you some basic principles rather than an exact how-to do that. And so let me give you a couple of these big principles, give you one illustration from my life and teaching, and then let you all talk for a few moments before I wrap it up with one big thought to kind of weigh heavy on you until Monday. First of all, you need to make sure you're visibly a Christian in the classroom. I don't mean having a cross around your necklace like a priest, or the earrings, or some of us are old enough to have our tried and true WWJD bracelet, you know. Visible, or you know, the fish on your car, like somehow that's an evangelism tool. It's an identity marker, but it's not an evangelism tool. What I mean by being visible is you've got to, in the classroom, present yourself and your material in such a way they know you're a Christian. Now, it might begin with prayer. Praying for the class, praying for the well-being of the students, praying for information that God will enlighten you, praying for their needs, if you can get needs out of them. Sometimes they're afraid to give you needs, but then they'll start feeding to you before class or after class. Can you pray for this? Challenge with prayer only, though, is if somebody comes late, like students sometimes do, they've missed the prayer. And if that's the only integration in your class, guess what they didn't get? They didn't get any Jesus that day. And so that's part of being visible. It might be doing a devotional. One of my history friends does a devotional every week. It's a short one. But he dedicates part of his class every week to giving a devotional thought. Not just to merely, here's a pontificating thought, but digging into it a little bit. And he realizes it's taking into time that he needs for teaching the subject. But his answer is, I can condense the subject to fit my time, but I will never get this student again and the opportunity to share my faith with him. And so he makes it a priority to share his faith through these devotional thoughts every week. For you, it might be, as you're doing it, simply a matter of attitude. We talked about this yesterday. If a student asks questions all the time and you're jubilant and excited, yeah, well, let's talk about this, that's positive. If your shoulders slouch and you roll your eyes, you just told them they're not important, and you may have just told them the topic's not important. Right? That's classroom management. You got to find a way to tell them, we can't do that today, let's get back to it. Sometimes I try to do it just to get them engaged, to keep them engaged, but I recently had a case where the student was an agnostic. He was argumentative, he wanted to fight, and his questions were always driven by that agnostic. Why would God have him kill all the Canaanites? You know, this like the people, all the Bible's full of errors until you ask them to show you one and they can't. He'd heard that the Canaanites were all killed, and so God must be to blame, and so I tried to answer it. On another occasion, we were talking about David and Goliath and how Saul wanted to give David his armor, because Saul's mocking David for wanting to fight the giant, and David couldn't wear it, he couldn't walk. And so he takes Saul's sword with him. Ultimately, he doesn't use it. And the student, who's a skeptic, goes, well, if David couldn't wear his armor, how could he carry a sword? And he just kept at it. And I kept trying to say, the verse, this is, I'm just telling you what the text says. And finally, I'd had enough of about 5 minutes of this banter in a 50-minute class, because the text says, end of story. Afterwards, there was an older gentleman who was auditing the class. And I said, I blew it, didn't I? Because I didn't want to turn the guy off. And he said, no, I'm surprised you waited as long as you did. But what was fascinating with it is that student, A, never interrupted class again, possible negative. He started coming to me after class with his questions. And he started coming with a desire to actually hear the answer rather than argue. As long as I was willing to banter with him, he was going to banter. But when he realized I wasn't going to waste my time if he didn't want to learn, he changed his tune. And so we've got to, our attitude has to be part of this. So being visibly Christian, we need to be intentional. We need to be intentional about this. This doesn't happen by accident. And I say that as a person who teaches Christian studies. You can teach Christian studies without being faith integrated. If you went to a secular university, you know what I'm talking about. There are religion classes that are not automatically integrated in terms of our faith. You need to be intentional and not go, oh, I hope it happens today. You've got to be looking for it to recognize it when it happens, maybe when the opportunity presents itself in a way that all of a sudden you didn't anticipate. Now I want to take this moment and use this one as that so-called teachable moment. You know, it's like if you say you want to lose weight, you can't just keep doing what you're doing. You have to be intentional about it. You know, when I was going through my studies, I had a professor brag about how dedicated he was to his studies. And he would get in there and he'd get in his office at night and he'd shut the door and he'd be working on his dissertation. And he could sometimes hear his son just outside the door laying on the floor trying to look under the door to check on dad. And I said, I'm never going to be that way as a dad. Because my son, who was at the time 2 or 3, is more important to me than this book I'm writing. And so I got intentional about it. And I never studied I did my undergrad in my 30s and went straight through. I never studied until he went to bed, which meant I was up sometimes at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, or when I was writing my master's thesis, I wrote through the night multiple times, 24 hours up. Thank goodness I think well when I'm tired, and I cranked it out, but you have to be intentional. You can't do this by accident, because guess what happens if you do things by accident? They don't happen. And all of a sudden your students don't know you love them, they don't know that you're actually trying to integrate, so you need to be intentional about it. Here's another principle, it's a little longer. You need to change how you look at integration, this idea, and your discipline. You can't shoehorn your faith into your discipline. That's what some people think is going to happen. We have this conversation this week, you're going to start doing it by accident. Your students are too smart for that. They're going to recognize when you're faking it, when you're all of a sudden what I call baptizing a document or an idea. Oh, they just took that and made it Christian because they said it. No, it's got to really be there. There has to be a legitimate connection. But the thing is, you've got to start off by acknowledging there's a connection. And so you've got to change that. You've got to come at it with the expectation, I'm going to find those areas where my ideas and my discipline and my faith actually intersect. You got to look for them sometimes. Some of your disciplines are difficult. C.S. Lewis, and this again, Liffen mentions this illustration in his book. It's elsewhere in Lewis's writing. Everybody's familiar with C.S. Lewis, right? Author of Mere Christianity. Christianity Today said this is the number one most influential Christian book of the 20th century. I disagree. I thought it was J.I. Packer, Knowing God, but they didn't ask me, so we'll go with their survey. Our students know him for one other reason. He made movies, right? Chronicles of Narnia. They've not read the books. They read the Cliff Notes. They watched the movie. But they know who he is. Many of you do as well. But Lewis is brilliant. He's got a great way with words. He's a wordsmith and everything. And he gives an illustration of this. He talks about one time in his garden in England, he went into a shed to get a tool. The door must have shut behind him, and he found himself in the dark. Ever go inside from the bright light into a dark room? Immediately you're Stevie Wonder, and you have to wait for your eyes to adjust. And as his eyes adjusted, he started to get his night vision, he noticed on the floor there was a beam of light shining, and he could see the little dust motes floating in the air. And so he started focusing and thinking about those dust motes. Man, how dirty is this shed? I need to clean this out. And then it dawned on him, I'm thinking about the wrong thing. I'm not asking myself the important question. I'm focusing on the matter, but it just dawned on him, where did the light come from? And so he shifted his perspective. He changed how he looked at it. And all of a sudden, he's now looking at the source of the light rather than just the object illuminated. That's what we do when we integrate faith and learning. We no longer just focus on the object. We're asking ourselves, what does the object tell us about the source? And all of a sudden, that cellular level you've been talking about tells you something about God, not just the cell. We don't ignore the cell and go only immediately to the Sunday school lesson. You start with a cell, but then now you begin to ask yourselves and your students, what does this teach us about God? Let's change the way we look at it. And so that's what I mean by changing the way you look at integration. Look, be aware. The intersections are there. you don't always see them if you're not looking for them. Another principle is you need to change specifically how you look at your discipline. Here, what I'm talking about is it's very easy for us to study our fields, especially those of you who went to secular universities for your higher level learning. It's easy to look at your field through the lens only of the secular training world. I mean, you all studied at good schools, you got great degrees, you learned a lot of stuff from great professors, but you need to realize there's more to it than just that. Dr. Brewer hit at this yesterday just a little bit. Liffen talks about it more in the book. When you talk about whatever discipline yours is, and you compare your approach in a Christian world versus the secular approach, you all are covering the same material. You're looking at the same stuff. You're talking about the same processes. You actually have the harder teaching job, not trying to find the faith in it, but to understand the faith in it. And so in many ways, they accuse us, the secular world does, of having Sunday school and somehow our educations are inferior here. In fact, if we actually begin to integrate, our education has become superior because we've now taken the education level higher, past where they do with their students. That's when you begin to integrate. So you need to think about your discipline specifically. How does this teach me about God? And what presuppositions have I brought with me from my training that not that I need to shake, you don't shake Einstein, you can't throw away Darwin's influence in the 1800s or whatever, but now you've got to ask, what else can I bring to my students that they may not find in a textbook, that they're not going to get by watching a YouTube video or whatever? That's what I'm driving at here. Now, sometimes we're going to be accused of, oh, you're trying to force it into it, or you're trying to put the students in a box and make them think everything Christianly. William Dearness said this. He says, Christianity doesn't put people in a box. It gives us a window to see the world. It gives us lenses. It's the grid through which we observe everything. There's a term we use for it. We all have a worldview. And to break all the rules of the grammarians in the room, I'm going to give you a definition by using the word in the definition. A worldview is how you view the world. That's a case where there's no easier way to say it. But every worldview, and everybody has one, they don't always necessarily admit it or realize it, everybody has a worldview. Every worldview answers certain questions about life. Everyone, whether it's a Buddhist worldview or an atheist worldview or the Christian, we all answer certain basic questions, and we all deal with them. This is a great way, by the way, to do evangelism. Don't attack them. Don't tell them they're going to hell. Begin to engage them. Let them talk about themselves. What do you think about X? Their worldview comes through, and now you can begin to dissect it. Do you realize this is what you're saying? Do you understand that this doesn't work? That this is, and so every worldview has a way of answering these key questions. One of my favorite little primers on worldview that I use with my students is from a guy named Mark Cosgrove. It's a little about 140-page book, and he goes through all the major worldviews in the world, like 9 or 10 of them, and in like 5 or 6 pages each, breaks down how they answer these key questions. I want to share with you the key questions, and as you're doing it, I want you to think about, how does your discipline answer this question, or how can your discipline help answer this question for the student? Because all of a sudden, you may bring in a perspective through your lens that the students never thought of, and it might be the tipping point in their spiritual life. Then all of a sudden, that's it. And they have that light bulb moment. Every worldview answers this question. Where did we come from? What's the origins, right? Big Bang, creationism, reincarnation is an argument for where they come from. Everybody has one. Whether it's a cosmic accident or whatever it is, that's a beginning point with every student in your classroom. They're bringing in a worldview that answers that question. And your discipline or your topic that they may begin to answer that form in a way they've never thought before. Give them the ability to defend their faith, to bolster their faith, or maybe to begin to understand your faith. And so everyone answers, where do we come from? Every one of them answers, what's wrong in the world? Every worldview admits the world's not a great place. It's not perfect. For Richard Dawkins, the biologist who is so virulent about his hatred towards religious systems, he thinks we're the problem. If you could just get rid of the Christians, the world would be a better place. And the sad thing is, as mean-spirited as it is, it's probably because he's never seen a Christian who lives like one. And so his world would be no better or no worse off, that is, without him. What does that say about the church around him? That's true of our students also. But everyone's got a, what's wrong? Is it sin? Is it karma? Is it just the fickle finger of fate, to borrow a line from back in the 60s? All those things are ways to answer this. Maybe your topic today answers this. What does William Faulkner's dark, moody writings have to say about what's wrong in the world? He's got an observation. The third question is, what's the answer? If there's this universal problem or problem set, what's the answer? Maybe your discipline has that answer. You know, social work, we can help begin to address the brokenness, but is it the ultimate answer? Well, let me tell you how this works, but notice it's incomplete. What's the next step for us? And so every worldview answers that. Some think the answer is reincarnation. You do it over, right? You fix it next time, which is ironic, because how can you fix it if you don't remember the last time? You're actually getting punished for something you don't remember doing. But that's the worldview answer. And the fourth worldview question is, where are we going? By which I mean, what happens when you die? Everybody's got one, an answer. To heaven, to hell, to reincarnation, nirvana, release, right? Moksha, get out of all this. Go back to the dust. You know, they want to borrow, don't they? There are ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and say, no, that's the real world. But here's where you got a point. Here's where you can grab them, because most worldviews are inconsistent. Most people pick and choose, including your students, by the way. Even your Christian students, or odds are, not going to have a consistent worldview, because they've been influenced by whoever the latest, greatest star is in the movies or music. And so they're borrowing mixed ideas. This is how they give you sometimes the answer. You go, I thought he grew up in the church. Because they're borrowing ideas. But when you catch them in the inconsistencies, let them know you caught them. You know, for example, those who believe life is meaningless, we die, that's it. Ask them, well, why do you cry then at somebody's funeral? That's just the way it is. If you believe survival of the fittest, in the oldest sense, as Darwin and his early followers tried to tell it, if you believe survival of the fittest, that's the way it is. The strong survive, right? This is the Ubermann of Nietzsche. This is Hitler's whole argument. If you believe that, why do we worry about the hornbill owl? We ought to just kill them all. Prove we're the strongest. And yet, what do they want to do? Protect the owl. In fact, they want to diminish the strength of the strongest and make it something lesser to protect the lesser, which, by the way, is a Christian ideal. They're being inconsistent. Let's come back around and talk about these ideas. But everybody's worldview answers those questions. Your discipline may not have all the answers, but it might point them to the answers. And so here's an easy way to bring it into the discussion. What does the way the Jewish people's persecution in Nazi Germany and the church's indifference to it tell us about the human condition, what's wrong in the world? What should they have done? And now all of a sudden that historical discussion can become a spiritual discussion. Or as one mentioned earlier, she asked the probing question, am I any better of a person than Hitler was? And the student's answer is, well, of course you are. And she said, well, no, what does the Bible say about the human condition? And then turned it into a discussion about evil. And that he could have easily also have repented and been saved had he chosen to respond that way. And so every worldview is trying to answer these questions for us. You need to ask, what does my field say? This one we touched on yesterday, so I don't want to beat this one very long. We need to change the way we look at our students. One of the great things we started doing probably 20, 30 years ago in higher ed is we realized to a large measure our students are consumers. For years in the education world, we treated them like they were there for our existence. It gave us an opportunity to talk about what we were interested in, whether they cared or not. And then one day we realize if we treat them like that, they go to somewhere else who does care about them. And so one of the value-added things about a Christian college is we supposedly care. That's a great thing, but as I mentioned yesterday, they're more than even that consumer. Remember, they're in the image of God. And so that changes everything. Because now they are more valuable than a dog. They're more valuable than me just merely getting to talk about what I want to talk about for an hour. I'm trying to tell them something that is potentially eternally valuable for them. And so we've got to change how we look at students, if you haven't already, to realize their eternal value and weight. And even that most aggravating student. We should rejoice they're in the classroom because they could be somewhere else where somebody could treat them like probably they've been treated their whole life, whereas we can change the entire way they intersected with the world by treating them like God would have treated them. You know, what's he saying? You can tell a lot about a man by the way he treats his dog. You can tell a lot about a professor by the way he treats his students. Conversely, you can tell a lot about a man by how his dog treats him. We adopted a shelter animal, a white German shepherd. Cute dog, male. He's timid. German shepherds aren't supposed to be timid. Our female that we already owned bullied him from day one. He knows his place. I mean, they might as well be married because he's got it figured out. But we quickly realized he was probably abused. The people loved him enough that they took him to an adoption service rather than just putting him out on the street. But when you go to pat him on his head, immediately it goes down. We've had him for 2 years, and it still happens. He's got to come to you on his terms and cozy up to you. And then he'll lay with his head on your shoulder. He's a big lap dog. Your students are that way. Many of them are broken. You're the first people who cared about them. You become surrogate parents, don't you? And those relationships, it won't be with every student, but those relationships come to the most special. I've got a student, I think I mentioned her yesterday. She came to me, her parents died 2 years before she came to college. She was angry, she was rowdy, she was gonna live the college experience to its hilt, right? She was gonna major in partying, or was it party planning? Is that what somebody said yesterday? Party planning. Party planning 101. She took me for Old Testament her first semester and became a Christian. Ooh, shocking. How does that happen? And over time, I became, in one sense, not only her father in the faith, but kind of a spiritual dad. She calls me for questions. What do I do with this? Why are these things happening to me? She took me for more classes than anybody else who's ever taken me. She's not a mini-me. She doesn't regurgitate everything I said. She learned her own theology. But she was in Charleston last week for a visit with family and friends. Guess who she called or texted? I'm in town. Can you see me? And I had her to my house for dinner. And guess what she's now probably still talking about a week later? I got to go to his house and meet his family and see his children in his house. And he fed me. And so when she was texting me on the way home while her friend was driving, she was talking about how great it was to finally meet my wife and children and see them as I've described them. That's treating them like they're valuable rather than just commodities to us. So we got to change how we look at them as a student. Let me give you a personal example of this in terms of integrating faith and learning. Then I want to kind of shut it down for a minute, let you all talk for a couple minutes, and then close with one last big thought. Everybody goes, oh, you teach church history. It's easy. It's integrating faith and learning. Not necessarily. Even in a Christian institution, it would be easy for me to just give the facts. If I were to do a quick survey and ask how many of you don't like history, the odds are it's probably at least half of you, if not more. And some of you are going, yeah, don't make eye contact. Because you had somebody teach you church history who was not passionate about it. They just gave you the facts. Know this date, know this war, know this person. I intentionally don't teach history that way. I teach a few key dates. I teach ideas and people. But I could teach, for example, on the question of the Reformation in the 16th century. I could teach it about it as the beginning of the nation state, because that's when we shift from being centralized in the Roman Emperor. He loses power and respect because of the whole Martin Luther thing, off launched the power of the local princes and powers. That doesn't have to be faith-oriented. I could teach it about the theological ideas. Here's what Luther's big idea, big idea, big idea. Or I could come at it and make the argument, which I think is a valid theological argument, even though Mark Knoll, again, we referenced him earlier, believes that Christian historians should never ask the why, because we can't figure out what they thought 500 years ago. All we can do is say what they did. So he wants a descriptive history. I believe in a prescriptive history. What can we learn from it and see in our lives changed? Because I think God says in Isaiah 46, 9 and 10, he says, I'm the Lord your God. There are no other like me. And then he says, what makes him different is, I have declared the end from the beginning. What has not yet happened will. So he says, I'm the God of history. So I study history as, what can it teach me about God? And so when I teach about the Reformation, one of the things I point out is, here's all the stuff, here's all the facts, here's the figures. Then I point out to them, you realize The Reformation is when God saved the church. The Bible promises the gates of hell are never going to prevail. Well, by 1500, it looked like the gates of hell had just basically prevailed. The average priest, only 7% of them could read scripture themselves. All they were doing was reciting what they'd memorized. It meant nothing to them. Many of the priests did not live in their parishes. And in their doctrines, you had to take the sacraments to be saved. Well, if he's not there to give them to you, guess what he has power over in your case? Your soul. And so hell seemed to be taking over. Some of the popes were incredibly base and worldly. And God uses Luther at the right time in the right place after the Gutenberg press is invented, and he changes the course not only of Luther's life, not only the church in terms of Catholic now and Protestant, I would argue he changed the course of human history. Because think about what impact now those Europeans with multiple faith options and arguably what I would say viable faith option, now they become missionaries and they take hospitals with them and they send missionaries to the Far East. And all of a sudden, everybody on the planet is impacted by what one little monk did in 1517. Now we've moved from facts to faith. And all of a sudden, the students are going, this stuff matters. Because it is, to use their word, relevant. Spend a couple of minutes with you all. Personal examples in your own classroom. How do you integrate? What have you seen or what have you done that works? Or what mistakes did you make, if you're willing to get them on tape?
Logically, the book is teaching you evolution. If they say that everything has intrinsic value because it exists, I'm like, if evolution is true, really, why does it matter? Kind of like you were saying. Think about the logic pathway of that. It doesn't make any sense. It's only from an understanding that God created the diversity we see around us, and so we're the reason, we're the ones that should care about diversity, and so this is why we should take care of the earth. You know, so to kind of pull it out at times besides just evolution when they are expecting it.
Right. Well, good. Somebody else. Again, there are no right and wrongs. The question is, do it or not? Somebody else. Somebody else, I heard somebody's lips smack like they were getting ready to talk and they stopped. No volunteers. Anybody else? Let me give you another way I do it sometimes. Again, I teach Old Testament and New Testament every semester. Depends on what they need. These are large surveys. Every student on campus has to take both. So you got half the class at least doesn't want to be there. They're doing this because they got to get to that. This is the necessary evil, ironically, to their life. And so I try to keep it interesting. I try to keep it engaging. You know, again, I try to be real for them that, you know, Dr. Beck is human. He makes mistakes. He says silly things. He laughs at jokes that may not be funny. You know, he's the guy who took a selfie of himself in his convertible. But sometimes opportunity presents itself to integrate faith where you hadn't planned it. Remember several years ago when Osama bin Laden is killed? My students knew my background in special operations. They wanted, hey, Dr. Beck, this happened over the weekend. What do you think? What they're doing is they're poking and prodding. They want to know, what do I know? Based on my experience, how am I interpreting what was, at that point, just now starting to come out? Of course, we leaked the national secrets a week later and told everybody. But early, no one knew. Was it Delta Force? Was it the SEALs? What about this helicopter that they supposedly left and blew up? You know, how would that have worked? How would they have found him? Those sort of things. And so I began to answer those questions in New Testament. Just chase this rabbit. And then I said, but let me make you think about it a different way for a minute. Because you all saw this on the news, probably on Twitter or Facebook. They didn't see the news. They got it in little snippets from their friends. But I said, how many of you saw so many people celebrating this as a victory for America? And I said, the patriot in me wants to celebrate because he got his just desserts. But I said, how many of you saw Christians or people who say they're Christians, lamenting the fact that he now has no more opportunity to repent and be saved? I said, how many Christians over the weekend celebrated the death of a being in the image of God and with no remorse because he got what he deserved? I said, hey, that makes us look bad. And I said, on behalf of the Christians, let me apologize. But I said, also, that idea that he got what he deserved, if that's the case, guess what every one of us in the room deserves? the same thing. Now, let me tell you about grace. And then so I'm able to bring in the cross from their discussion into the topic. Same thing with Robin Williams when he died. I think he's one of the great comic geniuses of my lifetime. But he's also one of the most tormented souls. Guess what you now talk about in class? Depression, suicide. Why? What could we have done to help him? Well, social work, sociology, psychology. But those things may not have fixed him. What did he really need? He needed hope. And you turn the corner through your discipline back to the bigger picture. And so very often what I do is I let them bring it up. I'm going to get on my topics. I'm going to cover the material I want to cover. But I want to talk about what they're interested in. And yet again, another value to the social media. Not only do they see my life, I see theirs. And I can address things I know they're dealing with without necessarily grabbing them and going eyeball to eyeball. I see you made a sexual mistake this weekend. I don't need to do that. But I can address sexual issues from the biblical text that day. Or I can talk about how Luther struggled with sexual issues or whatever. So integrating has to be intentional. You got to be looking for it. But it's not always the obvious, oh, cells, multiple complexities, oh, must be God. It may be something entirely unexpected that day. And that's when you go, this discussion is now more important than that for a moment. And let's chase it. Let me give you one closing thought and then send you on your way to lunch. This is the words of Jesus coming up. Everyone, when he is fully trained, will be like his teacher. What will your students be like? You're helping set the trajectory of their lives at a very important point in their lives. What will they become? Will they become a scientist because you're passionate? Better yet, will they become a Christian because you believe it? Will they follow your example? Jesus says they do automatically. The question is, what will they become when they're done? That's when we're integrating. And so that's the real challenge for all of us. Let me thank you for it real quick. And then if you got any questions, we can stay and talk or dismiss you to go and enjoy some fellowship and kind of sit at your tables and ponder the meaning of the universe and think about something else for a few minutes. Thank you all. Appreciate your time, your energy.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.